Hello, and welcome to the 2022 Southeast Collaborative Online Conference. My name is Lauren Clossy, and I am the Continuing Education Consultant for the State Library of North Carolina, and I will be your host for this session entitled Critical Cataloging: What, Why, How? This event is supported through funding from the Library Services and Technology Act through the Institute of Museum and Library Services. Please feel free to ask questions or make comments in the chat, or interact with other attendees and the speakers within the Whova app for this presentation. And now I would like to introduce our speakers, Alyssa Nance, Tiffany Henry, and Anna Kraft. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you so much for coming to our presentation, Critical Cataloging: What, Why, How? If you'd like to access the slides through Google Slides, you can do that through the Go link on the screen. It's go.uncg.edu/scoc2022. Next slide. My name is Alyssa Nance. My pronouns are she, her, and I am the Institutional Repository Metadata Analyst at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro.
Hello, I'm Tiffany Henry. My pronouns are she, her, and I'm the Discovery Cataloger at UNC Greensboro.
And I'm Anna Kraft. My pronouns are also she, her. I'm the Coordinator of Scholarly Communications here at UNCG, and this is a new position for me. I previously was in a very metadata-focused position, which is how I came to be involved in this work. Next slide, please. So we'd like to start with a brief land acknowledgement. We would like to acknowledge the lasting legacies of slavery and settler colonialism on the land on which we live and work in what is now Greensboro, North Carolina. This land has long served as the site of meeting and exchange amongst a number of indigenous peoples, including the Eno, Kiawi, Okanichi, Sara, and Shikori. North Carolina has been home to many indigenous peoples at different points in time, and we would like to honor and respect the diverse peoples connected to this territory from which we're speaking with you today. We also want to recognize that it's impossible to separate the history of this land from the long history and lasting legacy of slavery in this country, and particularly where we live in the American South. And the image that you see on this slide is the land from which we are speaking to you. So this is the UNCG campus in 1972. That's an image from our archives and special collections. Next slide, please. So we want to welcome y'all. We're here to talk about learning to implement critical cataloging practices in our department at UNCG. But first, we want to provide some background about critical theory, critical librarianship, and critical cataloging. And to get us started with that, I'm going to hand this back to Alyssa.
Thank you. So as Anna said, I'm going to get us started by talking just a little about critical theory and some basic concepts in critical librarianship as a whole. Next slide. Trying to find a good basic layperson-friendly definition of critical theory is kind of tricky. A lot of the foundational literature assumes a lot of knowledge or of related concepts or uses jargony technical terminology. But I did find an essay by Robert Cooley that I think does a decent job. And the full citation for that is on the resources list linked at the end if you're interested. Cooley defines critical theory as a social theory that examines the constraints of society and culture, assuming that by explaining and understanding them, we promote rationality, freedom, individuality, and community. Next slide. Cooley also says that critical theory switches the question of truth into a question of power. It tries to unmask the power relationships that lie behind our ideas of what is true. And this really starts to get at what we mean when we talk about critical theory. Next slide. So very basically, in order to understand and improve ourselves and the world around us, we need to understand the power structures that shape the way we live. We're all products of our own histories, we as individuals, but also the structures of culture, society, and institutions. Understanding all of these things involves a lot of questioning and interrogation and deconstruction. Who holds power in a given situation and who doesn't? Why? How have past systems of power shaped current systems? How do our current systems of power reflect and reinforce the oppression that we can see in our histories? To not change to the current constructions of power, we have to understand them. And these questions can help identify instances of oppression and how power is wielded to create that oppression in systematic ways. Next slide. Oppression can exist in obvious ways, but it's also built into everyday life in ways that we may not always pay attention to because it's so normalized. These are some general examples of ways that oppression can appear in day-to-day life. Oppression shows up in the design of spaces, things, and infrastructures, public goods and services, the financial, medical, and criminal systems, education, and so on. It's a long list. And an important thing to keep in mind is that groups of oppressed people are incredibly diverse and experience oppression in very different ways. So a person who is a queer, disabled Black woman, for example, is going to have a very different and more complicated experience of oppression than a queer, disabled white woman or a straight, able-bodied Black woman. And that increasing complexity of oppression is what is meant by intersectionality. Next slide. The flip side of oppression is privilege. Privilege is simply the experience of not being oppressed and doesn't indicate a person's happiness or quality of life. There are also many types of privilege, just as there are many types of oppressed people. So a person can be oppressed in one way, but privileged in many other ways. Acknowledging privilege may feel uncomfortable at first because we tend to associate it with something special, but privilege and oppression are actually both quite ordinary, and it's crucial to engage in that acknowledgement in order to move forward. Next slide. As with privilege, a lot of us, probably mostly white people living with white privilege, may have knee-jerk reactions to the idea that the concept of white supremacy exists outside of hate speech or hate groups. That defensiveness and discomfort with talking or thinking about racism as an active, embedded aspect of society can be a really important thing for people to sit with, to lean into, and to work through as individuals in order to fully engage with critical anti-racist work. That discomfort can tell us a lot about our own assumptions and internalized biases. The link on this slide is to an open access book called Knowledge Justice, edited by Sophia Leung and Jorge Lopez McKnight. The book as a whole addresses critical race theory and librarianship, but I especially recommend the introduction for getting oriented to conceptual ideas related to CRT, including white supremacy. Next slide. Critical librarianship is the practical application of critical theory concepts to libraries. Next slide. These principles are verbatim section headings from Emily Drabinsky's 2019 article, What is Critical About Critical Librarianship? And I think they provide a good general framework for critical librarianship, or otherwise called CritLib. Critical librarianship interrogates the work of power in structures and systems, acknowledges the social, economic, and political context of library policies and processes, surfaces hidden labor, articulates the infrastructures that enable some lines of inquiry and not others, and knows that the world could be different. Next slide. So what does that mean? These are some of the ways that the embedded systems of power in our libraries impact how oppressed people interact with and access libraries and archives and their materials and information. Critical librarianship considers how library accessibility, collection development and display, organization and description, policies and programming, among many other aspects of librarianship, may perpetuate oppressive systems. Next slide. These are a few questions that we might ask to look for ways that library systems of power might be oppressive. Do disability or socioeconomic status impact a user's ability to access library spaces, programs, or materials? Do any library policies impact some groups of people more than others? Do any users experience harm in using the library? Are all users able to find and use what they need? Next slide. Critical librarianship seeks to counteract the cycle of institutional reoppression created by libraries through prevention and remediation. Some forms of remediation may include abolishing overdue fines, reconsidering other user policies, ensuring that digital materials and systems meet accessibility standards, crafting equitable collection development policies, and evaluating the workplace culture and employee policies and procedures. Critical librarianship can also involve the examination of how information and materials are organized and described. And that is where critical cataloging comes in. And I'm going to turn things over to Tiffany.
Thank you. So today I will talk about critical cataloging, implications for libraries, and opportunities to implement some of these concepts. First off, let's start with some definitions. Critical cataloging, or CRCAT, is an offshoot of both critical librarianship and radical cataloging. As described by Watson in their 2020 article, critical cataloging is a subset of radical cataloging. To paraphrase from the article, critical cataloging has the same ethos as radical cataloging, but the philosophical framework of critical librarianship. One definition of radical cataloging comes from the preface of Radical Cataloging, Essays at the Front. K.R. Roberto, who is also the editor of the book, describes radical cataloging as being user-focused with regards to your library's users, having a healthy dose of skepticism about the quality of readily available bibliographic records, knowing when and how to make cataloging decisions that may conflict with traditional cataloging standards. A recent and succinct definition for critical cataloging also comes from Watson's article. They define critical cataloging as a social justice-oriented style of radical cataloging that places an emphasis on radical empathy, outreach work, and recognizes the importance of information maintenance and care. Critiques of cataloging systems like Library of Congress subject headings or LC classification aren't new. Some date back to the 1940s. Berman's book, Prejudice and Antipathies, originally published in 1971 with a second edition in 1993, is credited with bringing critiques to the popular discourse in librarianship. The primary focus of Berman's book is on issues with Library of Congress subject headings and its description of marginalized people and social groups with an eye towards correction. Other scholars such as Hope Olson, Melissa Adler, as well as Emily Drabinsky, just to name a few, have been writing about critical cataloging and critical approaches to topics like knowledge organization, cataloging practice, and more. Another noteworthy publication is the book mentioned earlier, edited by K.R. Roberto. It is one of the few, if only, books dedicated to various areas of radical and critical cataloging discourse. So let's transition and discuss the importance of critical cataloging and its impact on library services. How can critical cataloging connect to and impact library services and its users? What's the connection and impact in technical services and areas beyond that? I'm sure every library or institution either already does or wants to improve in the areas listed here, helping users find resources, reducing or mitigating harm, and engaging in EDI, or equity, diversity, and inclusion. There are ways that critical cataloging can help libraries in these efforts. These are four ways that we've identified where critical cataloging practices can help your library: improve access to resources and discovery of those items, mitigate harm to both library users and personnel, critically examining the value of neutrality, and promote inclusion. One benefit of critical cataloging efforts is improved access and discovery of library resources within our systems. Critical cataloging can spur projects that require revision to subject access metadata and resource descriptions that weren't captured before with traditional standards. Newer updated metadata captures dimensions of the resource that weren't visible before and can come to light and become searchable in library systems. Any metadata improvements can lead to better searching in the catalog and other systems. Another benefit is work towards ensuring relevant language in the metadata. This helps to ensure that the term and keywords that appear in the metadata are closer to the language that people utilize for their searches. Plus, making sure that authority data for authors and creators are both accurate and respectful is another area where critical cataloging can improve access to resources. Another point as to why the profession should care about critical cataloging is efforts to mitigate potential harm. People who interact with or maintain library systems we use might encounter harmful language or insensitive language. This is just a reality for any library users or staff who hold marginalized identities. Many of the library standards and systems we use today, like Dewey Decimal Classification or LC classification, were codified by those who hold the most power in our society. Therefore, the language used or what informs the structure of the systems will often reflect viewpoints held by the majority. Conscious efforts to address this are needed if we want to strive towards inclusivity. So without getting on a metaphorical soapbox, the main point I want to convey is that critical cataloging is one avenue to encourage us as professionals to think about, question, and maybe even challenge some of the assumed values within the profession. That same questioning can aid with inclusivity. Speaking more broadly, scholarship and critical librarianship has discussed the ways that libraries are actually not neutral institutions. Libraries also engage in systemic oppression. If neutrality is an advocated value across profession, as well as within the specialization of cataloging and metadata, it's worthwhile to think critically about its place in use. Neutrality is one of the values taught in LIS degree programs, shared in the literature on cataloging ethics, and statements created by professional organizations, such as the ones from ALA and IFLA. Going back to critical cataloging specifically, it can challenge the idea of cataloging neutrality. This value demands that we as catalogers cannot and should not bring their personal biases to their work. The idea of neutrality is to take the person out of the work and strive towards objectivity. But strict adherence to neutrality and objectivity doesn't lend itself to the individual self-awareness necessary for critical cataloging work. Self-awareness as an awareness of one's own personal biases and blind spots, the sorts of things that are informed by individual lived experience and identities held. While being neutral might be in place to prevent people from being bad actors and pushing their beliefs, it also takes away from the element needed to help identify things that need to change. Engaging in cataloging and metadata work cognizant of who we are in relation to what we're working with can be a potential benefit and good tool for catching places or spots that might need remediation. Taking ourselves out of the work is not to the benefit of furthering critical cataloging work. If the profession is keen on stating that the inclusion of others is a key value alongside diversity and equity, then we really need to take a critical examination of the idea of neutrality. Again, critical cataloging is one avenue that can help us do that. Going back to harm mitigation, strict adherence to neutrality doesn't allow for the work of reducing the possibility of it occurring in our catalogs and systems. This aligns with what critical cataloging has to offer given the social justice framework. Cataloging tasks such as subscription can include the omission of certain voices and inadvertently create silences. Work done for subject access for resources can still utilize harmful language, presumably not because people are purposely malicious, but often these things remain to adhere to rules, practices, and standards that are already established. Again, don't get me wrong, rules and standardization are very useful and needed in cataloging work, but we must acknowledge the possible expense. And here are some examples of how critical cataloging can connect to other areas of the library. Reference and instruction work is impacted by the access and discovery of resources. It's a vital aspect of the work to be able to meet users with what they're looking for. Efforts to mitigate harm found within archival description and challenge ideas of neutrality of the historical record are both areas where critical cataloging concepts influence the work. Plus, reference and instruction done within special collections and archives can gain the same access and discovery benefits. In terms of user experience, when critical cataloging concepts are implemented, they can help create a positive user experience for library users via seeing themselves reflected in the metadata and not encountering possibly harmful language in places like item description, keywords, and subject headings. So let's talk about potential opportunities to implement critical cataloging concepts at your institution. The ethical issues that come up with name authority work are meant to make us critically engage with the process of curating and maintaining that data. There's more to this work than capturing every single point of data that we can about a creator and making it available. These ethical issues include, but aren't limited to, issues surrounding personal privacy and the implication of making publicly available personal identifiable information like birth dates or place of residence in an era where this information can be potentially more sensitive than it ever has before. This includes balancing creators' rights to privacy and the right to consent for the information to be shared versus having the information available in a name authority record. Recording gender of a creator in a name authority record is also another ethical issue. Some might think this extra information is benign, but can have serious implications. Given that the standards and practices around recording gender information for a creator is steeped in ideas that normalize cis and binary gender identities, then issues arise when a creator's identity doesn't align. There's potential for harm in recording someone's gender because that information can potentially out them if they're trans, utilize a dead name, or just simply misgender them. Also, the issue with control of information comes up again. People should have agency over their own identities and how that information is disclosed. With name authority data, librarians should only utilize information about a creator that they've obtained consent to include or information already made publicly available by the creator. Another ethical issue is around culturally appropriate and sensitive ways to capture authority data. One example is determining the specific needs of Indigenous creators and their communities when the established structures, rules, and practices for creating name authority data is very much so steeped in Western and white cultural norms. These issues and more are explored in Ethical Questions in Name Authority Control, edited by Jane Sandberg. I would recommend this book to anyone who wants to learn more about the issues mentioned here and more. In terms of addressing some of these issues in your institution, taking time to revisit, revise, or create local guidelines for name authority data creation and maintenance is a good place to start. While there are national standards that catalogers need to adhere to, there is room to determine locally how to handle certain issues that arise with name authorities. Ways to incorporate critical cataloging for institutions that utilize Library of Congress subject headings include keeping important MARC records up to date within your ILS or integrated library system. Therefore, any major updates that get pushed out from Library of Congress and end up in WorldCat records will appear where needed. Also, you can participate in the Library of Congress subject heading proposal system. Make the sort of changes you would like to see. There's a guide written on how to submit proposals for LC topical subject headings written by Beck Schaefer outlining the process and collating the resources about the proposal process. Also, check to see what tools are available for your ILS or discovery layer to aid in the efforts to keep up to date with Library of Congress subject headings or make changes where desired. TRLN, or the Triangle Research Library Network, is a consortium of university libraries around the Raleigh-Durham-Chapel Hill area in North Carolina. They've developed a tool to overlay problematic Library of Congress subject headings with local alternatives. The underlying metadata in the MARC record remains the same, but users will see the alternative term in the catalog. Another way to bring critical cataloging work includes to your work includes considering alternatives to Library of Congress subject headings. There are many alternative control vocabularies or CVs that have official MARC codes so they can be placed in WorldCat records. Also, don't forget that there are CVs beyond just Library of Congress subject headings. Linked is a list of other CVs for subject cataloging, many of which are either managed by Library of Congress, a subdivision of Library of Congress, or other organizations like ALA. Another resource that people can turn to find an alternate CV that might better meet their specific needs is a list available from Cataloging Lab. Similar critical cataloging work takes place within archives and special collections too. Some examples of redescription and reorganization projects include the Reparative Archives Project by UNCG's Special Collection and University Archives Department, focused on remediating descriptive metadata for archival collections and their finding aids. This project addressed cultural sensitivity issues in the metadata. It also added positionality statements for collection creators. It also checked for and remediated instances of valorizing language or aggrandizement found within finding aid descriptions for collection creators. Duke University Libraries has also developed a tool to automate the process of auditing language in their special collection records and descriptions. This process will help staff with determining what needs attention and further review. Also, an offensive language statement was developed as a part of the Reparative Archives effort at UNCG. This statement is now on every finding aid, description, and digitalized online surrogate for items held by our Special Collection and University Archives Department. And now I will turn it over to Anna.
Thank you, Tiffany. So I'm going to talk about how we have gotten started with critical cataloging at UNCG involving some specific projects. Next slide, please. So first, just some very brief background about our department. So all three of us are based in technical services. This department is relatively young. It was created in 2016 by merging acquisitions and cataloging, which previously functioned as separate departments, though worked very closely together. We currently have 17 full-time equivalent employees, including faculty, staff, and temporary positions. And we're coming to you today not as experts on critical librarianship or critical cataloging, but as people who are actively working on learning in these areas. Next slide, please. And we support in tech services equity, diversity, and inclusion efforts on campus and in the libraries beyond just what we're talking about today. So there's some examples on this slide, and some of these are things that one or more of us are involved in. Some are things that others, our colleagues in the department, are involved in. These include diversity audits of our collections, participation in the Reparative Archives Working Group that was associated with some things that Tiffany mentioned a moment ago. Lots of professional development and learning, including following developments and changes in the profession in this area. And of course, we're actively working on skills and practices in specific areas, including critical cataloging and metadata remediation. Next slide, please. So we wanted to learn more about critical cataloging practices and improve our practices and skills. So we've been pursuing projects that will give us that hands-on experience. Next slide, please. And the first project that I'm going to briefly touch on is actually chronologically the second project that we are approaching. And this one is, I have less to say about it because it really is just in its infancy. So this idea came from Tiffany. I would like to give her credit for this. This will address and remediate Library of Congress call numbers that are impacted by a recent cutter number change. The previous cutter number was an N used in some schedules as applied to certain groups of people, in this case, Black and African American people. And this cutter was changed relatively recently to B. So what we would like to do is remediate these cutters to make that change from N to B. So we are following national standards, but also reflecting more current language. And you would think that this might be something very easy to do in terms of just, you know, changing some letters in the catalog. But actually, it's an interdepartmental effort because it's not just letters in the catalog. It also involves actual books in the stacks and making sure that the numbers on those books change and that they are located in the appropriate places and that we are able to identify all of the impacted materials. So for identifying those materials, we're working with colleagues in the systems department to get reports. And we're also going to have to work with colleagues in access services and in our processing area within tech services to make sure that we can get those books and change them and get them back to where they need to go. But one of the challenges with this is that we are preparing for a building renovation. And with that will come lots of collection shifting and some weeding. So what we don't want to do is pull all these materials, update them, and then weed some of them. So we only want to touch them once, if possible. So we're having to think about the logistics of this project within the logistics of this building renovation. But aside from that, establishing processes here for this change will hopefully prepare us for future changes of this type when we may have to remediate additional call numbers. Next slide, please. So I want to acknowledge that while the term we're using is critical cataloging, this work does not always involve MARC records and traditional bibliographic description. So these practices can also apply with other types of description, including non-MARC metadata. And that's what I'm going to talk about with our next project. Next slide, please. So we're doing a project that involves a subset of the Robert C. Hansen Performing Arts Collection and metadata associated with a historical sheet music collection that's held in that collection. So this sheet music dates from about the 1840s to the 1920s, Most of it is early 1900s. It's all sheet music, primarily songs, so most of them do have words. Many of them also have cover art, so there is also a visual aspect. And some of them also include advertisements for other musical compositions or excerpts, kind of teasers of other songs. So there's that component as well, this kind of commercial sales component. And the sheet music is digitized and available online. The link at the bottom of the slide would take you to that if you'd like to see them. Next slide, please. So here's a visual taste of what you may see within the collection. A couple of covers, some sheet music, a little ad that's from one of them. So there's a lot to see within the collection. Next slide, please. What we're not going to show you today is the many examples of objectionable images, words, and phrases that are found within the collection. Given the era of this collection and the very significant differences culturally between now and then, there's a lot of terminology that's used, a lot of images that are very caricatured, a lot of things that are happening in the contents of these materials that we don't want to show you today. And that's why we're working with this collection. So if you would like to see specific examples, we do have a slide at the end of the presentation that has some links, and you, if you would like, may follow any of those links to see some examples, but we are not going to be showing them today. Next slide, please. So this collection is actually one of the first ones that I worked on when I started my work at UNCG in 2011 as a metadata cataloger. And at that time, we were approaching this very differently. At that point, this collection needed some author name cleanup in the digital collections metadata, as well as the addition of Library of Congress subject headings to records in the digital collection. And for that, we were primarily pulling existing bib records in OCLC to get headings from existing records. And when we couldn't find records for the sheet music in question, we would create headings, but a lot of them were just pulled straight from library or from OCLC. And we were also taking opportunities to address other minor metadata and digital file issues as we encountered them, doing some cleanup. Next slide, please. So I want to acknowledge that 2011 was a very different time. So it was a different time in the world. It was a different time in libraries. There are many conversations that are happening now that were not happening then, or at least were not happening at the same levels. And for me, I was a brand new untenured library faculty member in my position. I had just started my job and I was an early career librarian. So it was a different time for me professionally as well. Next slide, please. So at that time, I definitely noticed problematic aspects within images and terms within this collection and the materials. And I really did feel uncomfortable with some of the things that I was seeing. But I didn't consider that we could discuss the problematic aspects and potentially address issues that we had found. That wasn't something that I considered as part of this potential work at that time. So we followed expected workflows and practices, didn't really think about questioning the practices that we had in place. And at the end, finished the project, moved on, and I didn't really think about it that much once we were done until we started talking about getting involved in critical cataloging. And then I was like, oh boy, I know where we can get started. Next slide, please. So this is something that we started last year, looking at this collection in a different way. So we've got, of course, all of that original metadata from 10 years ago. And now we're looking at it differently and specifically looking to provide more accurate and respectful metadata. And we're considering critical cataloging practices and looking for ways to implement them. And again, as we find other minor issues, we can do some cleanup. And this work is still in progress. Next slide, please. Why are we working on this collection? So as I said, there are many examples of problematic content and description, which give us opportunities to provide more accurate and respectful language. This collection is also a relatively manageable size. So it's about 500 items in this collection of sheet music. And so we've mostly divided it up into three. Among the three of us, we've got a spreadsheet. We're working through it sort of iteratively, consulting each other. And the size is pretty ideal for something like that. Also, we've got some good opportunities to learn from others in the profession who have similar collections. We are not the only institution that holds a collection of sheet music from this era, where that sheet music collection contains objectionable content. So we've been able to look at other examples in digital collections from other institutions, as well as reaching out to colleagues at other institutions. Next slide, please. And now to talk more about how we have approached this, I'm going to hand it over to Alyssa.
Thank you. So when we got started working on this project, we really weren't sure how to get to where we wanted to end up. So we started by looking around at what other institutions were doing, what literature was available. The reading we've done has certainly involved a lot of critical cataloging. But we've also done some reading about the works in the collection, their creators, some historical context, and critical analysis of those works. We've attended lots of webinars and conference sessions, and we've talked with folks at other libraries who are doing similar work. Next slide, please. So we started at looking by looking at our individual sections independently, and just kind of making notes about the issues, what they are, where they are, trends, and anything else about the materials that might be remarkable. And you can see part of like how we organized that on the screen. This is just a portion of the spreadsheet. A solid majority of the items actually don't need remediation, but we flagged about 20% of the collection for additional review. Next slide, please. So specific issues that we want to remediate are primarily related to racism or arise out of the legacies of slavery and colonization. So things like exoticism, Orientalism, xenophobia, and just generally the objectification of non-white peoples and cultures. Next slide, please. The works with the clearest options for remediation have been materials related to minstrelsy or containing instances of blackface. And when we're talking about minstrelsy in this collection, we mean blackface minstrelsy of the 19th century, that was sort of the predecessor to vaudeville. But we're not talking about medieval troubadours. So there are established headings, several that have been identified and established vocabularies that help describe these materials well. A number of other librarians have done work in this area. And I particularly want to mention Dorothy Berry's work, who I've linked to her website here, if you want to read a little more about minstrelsy description. Next slide, please. Grappling with issues outside of minstrelsy and blackface has been much thornier for a few reasons. Some concepts like xenophobia and exoticism are sometimes definitely present in song texts, but as a subtle undercurrent rather than the primary theme of images or lyrics. And so describing them accurately and usefully becomes difficult. Some racist imagery is coded rather than outright, and there aren't always accurate terms or useful terms available in controlled vocabularies. Next slide, please. So one significant decision in this project has been to use Library of Congress subject headings outside of the aboutness scope of material subject that you would normally expect. And we've chosen to use LCSH to describe genre and form when it's not available in another vocabulary. And I had prepared this example of using the LCSH term blackface to describe a work that contains an instance of blackface, but I actually just realized, like this morning, that there is an art and architecture thesaurus term for blackface that we might prefer to use. And Anna and Tiffany pointed out to me that this is a good example of how this work is a learning process and iterative and kind of messy. So we may also use LCSH to describe the textual content, and that is also complicated. A song might contain text that depicts or expresses racism against Black people, for example. So the question in that case becomes whether the song is about racism and whether the heading racism against Blacks might apply. And it's very messy and there's no clear answers with these. Next slide, please. One particular heading in the metadata that has required review is the floating subheading Songs and Music, which has a scope note and is to be used for works that are about a group of people described in the main heading. So the heading African Americans, Songs and Music should be used for songs about Black Americans. But the issue in our collection is that the songs are not about a real group of people, but about a racist stereotype of a group of people. Next slide, please. It took a while for us to get here, but we're starting to build some best practices for this project when it comes to applying headings and choosing which to use, when to use them, from what vocabularies. These are some of the headings that we've found helpful. And other than the LC genre form term humorous songs, these all have scope notes, and that's been very useful to us in evaluating which terms are the most appropriate, especially when we're differentiating concepts that we want to express as genres or forms rather than as subjects. Next slide. We are still in the process of selecting and deselecting, reviewing and finalizing the new headings. We'll do some reformatting on the metadata, and then we will be able to replace the metadata in a batch process into our digital collections. In the end, we hope, we expect our work on this project to inform practices and workflows on future projects. I'm hoping that some of our best practices might be transferable in the future, and we will create documentation to that end. Next slide. This project, not to like repeat myself too much, but it's very much been a learning process for us. And I very honestly, it's been a matter of figuring it out as we go. We've learned a lot about the historical context of the materials and creators, and I feel like I continue to learn something new every time I work on the project. We've learned that sometimes it's very easy to identify objectionable content and it's very clear, but some issues are more subtle and sometimes there are ambiguous gray areas. We've had to question our assumptions about and understandings of the materials and their creators. We've learned that we won't be able to address all of the issues that we've identified through metadata remediation. And finally, this work is a process and we are still learning. I'm gonna turn it back over to Anna.
Thank you. So we're gonna wrap up now and touch on some challenges as well as opportunities for people who want to get involved in this work. Next slide, please. So there are many potential challenges to taking on something new, and time is the biggest one that we have run into. So of course, we all have our regular jobs that we have to get done. So we may want to be spending time on critical cataloging projects, but we aren't always able to because of other things that we have to get done. And as mentioned before, we've got a major building renovation coming up that's going to impact everyone in the library. So that's going to be another thing that will be impacting us and our availability. There's also a challenge around expertise. So we came into this not as experts, but there are many learning opportunities out there. But also building expertise takes time. So this also, of course, connects to time. One challenge that we have not encountered, but that others might, is buy-in and support from one's workplace. Not all libraries or institutions may have support for taking on something new like this, especially if they don't see it providing an efficiency or something that's very clear about what the benefit is. Of course, there are ways that we can justify critical cataloging in support of remediating and mitigating harm and contributing to EDI efforts, but not all workplaces may have the same things in mind when considering taking on new work. Next slide, please. If you're thinking about getting involved in critical cataloging work, what you need is a willingness to learn, to question assumptions and practices, while working toward that goal of reducing harm and increasing inclusivity. And we've talked about an example of a collection that includes some objectionable materials, but that's not where you have to get started. You can think about these practices with many collections. So it doesn't have to be one that is blatantly offensive or objectionable. And seeking out learning opportunities is a great place to get started. We've got a resource list at the Go link here, go.uncg.edu/scocres. And that includes reading opportunities, as well as potentially some webinars. And there are lots of webinars that we've been seeing. So take a look, see what people are doing, and you may see opportunities to incorporate practices into your own work and your own library. Next slide, please. So a final thought. We've talked about some individual projects, the Cutter Project and metadata for the Hansen Project, that are part of our exploration of critical cataloging work. But our work in this area should not stop when those projects are complete. So this is an effort to build a practice and a culture that hopefully will extend beyond just these projects and into the larger department and the library. But it's definitely not going to be immediate. This is something that, as we have mentioned multiple times, this takes time. This takes learning. So it's all a process. Next slide, please. We want to thank y'all for being here today and thank the North Carolina State Library and Lauren for facilitating this and making this possible. Our contact information is linked here, as well as the Go links to the slides and the resources. So feel free to consult those if you are interested in seeing any of those materials. Next slide, please. And this is the slide that I mentioned earlier. If you would like to see direct examples of any of the things that we are not showing today, this is your opportunity to do that. Next slide, please. And again, we want to thank y'all, and we appreciate your time and being here today. So that's all that we have for you today.
Thank you so much to Alyssa, Tiffany, and Anna for sharing all of this today. This is such an important topic right now, particularly. So I want to thank you, and I want to thank everyone who is joining us today. If you have any other questions or comments that you would like to make or chat with the presenters, please feel free to reach out to them using the Whova app. And an evaluation is provided with the conference session resources, and we welcome your feedback on this session as well as about the conference. So thank you for making the 2022 Southeast Collaborative Conference successful, and we will see you all next year. Thank you so much.